Critical Thought TV. I'm your host, Stuart Mason Dambrot. Critical Thought TV has two roles. We look at consilience, the quest for a unified theory of human knowledge, and futurism, where we take what we know, we take scientific discoveries, and run them out into the future and see where that leads us. We're honored to have today as our guest, Jason Silva. One of the most interesting points that you covered in your recent talk at the Singularity Summit 2011
yes.
was the role of storytelling, narrative, and by implication aesthetics mm-hmm. within the context of the singularity hypothesis. Mm. And I'd like you to address that if you so desire.
Well, yeah, I mean, right off the bat, there's a problem with a lot of the way the vision of the singularity is being explained to people. Certainly, you can reach a subset of the population with graphs and mathematical projections and whatnot. I think that's great, obviously. But it's a little too dry to reach the mainstream. Mm-hmm. And the reason is that people tend to respond to what moves them. Presentation is as important as the ideas that are being presented. Art, design, right? Representation, framing, aesthetic relevance. How do you imbue ideas with meaning and with a sense of the meaningful underneath them so that these memes become viral, so that they infect the person's imagination and they have this urge to spread the idea like an inception that just spreads and everybody feels inspired by it.
So then one thing that you might be saying yeah. is that, for example, Damasio's newest book, he changed some of his earlier positions uh-huh. in neuroscience, uh-huh. pointing out, I think rightly so,
yeah.
that the emotional motivation and component of human experience and thought itself
yeah.
is too often discounted in our culture because, let's face it, of Plato and Aristotle,
right?
Where thought and rationality are abstracted from the inner experience
sure.
and emotions are over here.
Yeah.
But in fact, without those emotions, it's very dry.
So I totally agree.
So it seems to be that what you're saying is really coincidence with Damasio's
Well, yes, absolutely. I just think that, you know, it's like Roland Barthes, the poet, wrote in A Lover's Discourse. He said that fulfillment literally means to overflow, to exceed totality, to be more than full to the point that you spill over. And, you know, if the purpose of life is to be fulfilled, to have a life that is nourishing and that you wake up every morning with a sense of purpose and cosmic heroism, it's going to involve this, again, this idea of fulfillment, and it's a very kind of emotional experience that is to be more than full. So when people talk about, you know, the role of aesthetics or aesthetic arrest, I mean, who doesn't like to be held in aesthetic arrest, to be frozen by something that moves you, to be dumbstruck by awe, to be pushed to the limits by an IMAX film of the Hubble Space Telescope showing you the infinity of the cosmos in 3D, and you're sitting there watching it, gawking at the ubiquitous wonders that exist at all times in the entire universe that we're culturally conditioned to ignore. How sad is it that due to hedonic adaptation and our overly busy lives, we fail to apprehend the awe of the infinity that surrounds us at every moment? And aesthetics is the term to where that recognition of beauty and curiosity and wonder and awe permeates the human experience. We mediate it through this idea, okay, this is what aesthetics are, this is what the opera and the arts and this and that, but it's really everywhere. I mean, Leonard Schlein wrote Art and Physics. These are two sides of the same coin. Truth, beauty, right. philosophic wonder, aesthetics, all join forces.
The scaffolding of qualia, as it were.
I love that.
Yeah, that's something to that effect. So it also then would suggest something else, which is that within the context of what we find beautiful and what we find pragmatic, those yeah. are also usually separate. And
right.
that would seem to be a bad direction to go then, that we want to imbue our technology with a sense of wonder. And it can be writ very small, just a small epiphany, a
yeah.
small realization
yeah.
can have profound cognitive yeah. consequences for the individual.
Yeah. Well, you have just opened up the whole debate about like Apple versus like Windows or other PCs. You know, like most personal computers at one time were seen as like pragmatic and utilitarian, and it took Steve Jobs and Apple to imbue a reverence for beauty and aesthetics and a sense of design to these products, where they became more than just functional objects. They became, by all you know, they became works of art. They became transcendent. I mean, people talk about falling in love with their iPhones. I mean, it's a thing of beauty. When engineering reaches a certain level of complexity, it becomes simple. So a complexity that hits a crescendo where then it becomes simple and it feels like, oh yeah, this makes sense. I mean, when you look at the technology of the touchscreen in Apple products versus some others, you know, it's almost too perfect in the Apple product. It's so simple. But that simplicity requires all this engineering and all this complexity behind it.
And right, I think
that they really understood that. And, you know, when I go to the theater or watch a film like Inception, I'm in awe, not just at the ideas that are explored, the ideas that literally spill over and burst through the screen and give me an epiphany, but I'm also impressed by the design of the visual effects, of the way those ideas are portrayed in this narrative that becomes real, you know? Cinema is, I think, the most impressive art form that we've ever created, and it's the ultimate potentially form of aesthetics that we have thus far, but also a great way to transmit pragmatic information. You know, there's no better way to make people smarter than by giving them content that epiphanizes them. And if you can make that content beautiful, and if you can make it entertaining, then you've won.
So that would perhaps give you another rubric as an aesthetic, ecstatic documentarian.
Yeah.
In a way. So because documentaries can be informative.
Yeah.
But dry.
Right.
Some films can be emotional.
Yeah.
But not that meaningful.
Right.
Right. So the sweet spot is somewhere in the middle.
Yeah. I mean, you know, that famous documentary, Koina Skatsi, which was said to be so much more than a documentary, rather an aesthetic experience, you know, a transcendent journey of the senses, right? And this idea, I talked with my co-producer for our documentary that we're working on. We can get to that later. But he said, we want to make a Koina Skatsi, like, on LSD, focused on techno-optimism and the singularity. So imagine that. But, you know, as far as aesthetics, look, it really comes down to the singularly, singularly probably the most pleasurable experience that I've ever had. And it's the sense when you're moved by something so profoundly beautiful, by what Werner Herzog calls ecstatic truth, that it literally makes you weep. And aesthetic arrest. I enjoy nothing more than the sort of the overwhelming emotional catharsis that occurs when something, you know, really transforms you in a beautiful way. That feeling is the closest thing to everything's going to be okay that I've ever experienced.
And that phrase, ecstatic truth, it is kind of a gnomic moment in that whole conversation.
Yeah.
Because to think of truth, we usually think of it, at least in my experience, as something somewhat abstract, factual, even though facts are really opinions that mm-hmm. change slowly, more or less. But so something factual and dry, and then there's emotionality and, you know, dance, music. But really, truth can and should be ecstatic in its revelatory power.
Absolutely. There's that wonderful word, revelatory ecstasy. It's that ecstasy that is induced by the revealing, the bursting forth of an obvious truth that wasn't obvious before you actually understood it, you know? When you connect the dots and the gestalt, I never know how to pronounce this, when the new pattern is revealed and the new pattern literally subsumes the previous paradigm, you know, it reminds me of the line from The Imaginary Foundation, to understand is to perceive patterns. So the more we find ways to augment our ability to apprehend those patterns and see the feedback loops between our, you know, environment and our consciousness and how what we see and what we learn mediates how we come to understand the world, that is ecstatic. That's what the ecstatic poets are interested in. That's the difference between listening to Timothy Leary's way of articulating ideas and listening to other, you know, technologists or psychedelic visionaries. I mean, this guy really understood the power of performing philosophy out loud, you know?
So to summarize this section, we could say something like, given that we are here because of emergent properties of our universe,
yes,
then in fact that what it seems, this just occurred to me when you were talking about this, that the experience we have when we connect the dots,
yeah,
it's like our own biology saying to us, your purpose is to create, continually, as much as possible, create these emergent experiences.
Because they are emergent experiences. Every time you connect those dots, some new layer of understood knowledge is literally birthed into existence. It's like a new pattern that then will determine the outcomes of your entity and the other entities that you affect as you continue your unfolding.
And so, the entire neocortical structure involved, even the reticular activating information, all of the emotional components, there is this synchrony which occurs at a rate that cannot be accounted for by the speed of axonal propagation. So there's something going on in neurobiology at those moments which is transcended, possibly accounted for by electromagnetic field that's generated by the neocortex, but nonetheless, it feels great. It's unbelievable.
It feels great. It's the orgasm of the mind. And literally, people have said that your brain becomes synchronous during those moments.
That's like exactly
multiple
what I was getting
areas
at. Exactly.
light up.
That's
so this idea that something is taking place that is biochemically significant.
And is biochemically and neurologically nonlinear.
And could end up changing the fate of the whole universe because it starts a snowball effect. You know, the epiphany that one man had that ended up resulting in the jet engine, or the epiphany of select engineers that designed the wing of modern aviation jets, you know, or the epiphany of, you know, whoever decided that we were going to go to the moon in a rocket, you know, and the technologies that ended up becoming ubiquitous for the world due to that research and resources that went into that. So it's this idea that, you know, a man sitting on his couch could have an epiphany that could change the fate of the cosmos, and we might not know it for another 1,000 years or 25 years, doesn't mean that it won't happen. And so it's magical to think about.
And it even reaches into literature to close off this particular topic. By referring to Borges, when some of his writings, when the consciousness of an object ends up manifesting that object in space.
Amazing. Fist bump.